Thank you. I made it back. I knocked the fan down. Let's pick that up. Hello, everybody. Thanks for joining me. And let me fix this. There. My fan. I can't go anywhere without my fan. Something when I play, I got to have air moving over me. It's weird. When there's no fan, I don't play as good. You know, this is like a wind of energy. That's my little secret, my fan, and a little towel. I don't know what it is, but back in the 80s, maybe 90s, I used to sweat a lot more. Personal health fact. And now, I just played five gigs with Last in Line. We just came back last night. And I sweat, but not the same, you know? I think your body changes. So, I don't know, maybe I need to eat more pretzels. That's not good for you. Blood pressure. But anyway, we came back from Lala and I from five shows on the Midwest, the East Coast, not the East Coast, the Midwest mainly. And we did, what did we do out? Sometime we did Laconia. We did Westland, which is near Detroit. We did Pennsylvania, Sellersville. And we did Milwaukee at the casino. That was fantastic. And one more. Which, where the hell was that? I don't know. But there were five shows. So we had three shows, and then we had 4 days off, and then a show, a day off, a show. It's pretty easy. And all the guys flew home after the first three shows. But I'm sick of, like, I'm in California, and to go from the East Coast or Midwest to San Diego, where we're near, you got to take two flights. Very rarely do you get a direct flight, and that would have been Philadelphia to San Diego. And I thought about it and said, you know what, let's just stay on the road. We'll drive with Mark Weber, our tech, in the Sprinter van, and we'll just stop and take our time to go from Philadelphia over to Milwaukee. And we stopped at some weird places. Oh, you know. Yeah, so we stopped somewhere in the middle of nowhere, and it was this little store, and it was a gas station. There's nobody there, really, and looks like a Bates Motel in the background, like an old, old motel, one of those one-story jobs. The light, you know, vacancy light that looked like it was from Psycho movie. But we went in there, people were really nice, and Lala bought a beautiful leather jacket, and the prices were incredibly low. And I didn't buy anything because the men's jackets were too heavy. So we stopped there, but it was really weird. I mean, it was just crazy. The way they added up, she was trying to add up the price or something, and she came out with double the price. This woman's doing it by hand. Go, wait a minute, I think that's wrong. And then she's looking up the tax rate, and with a big book, let me get the tax rate. Gets the book, turns the pages, finds the tax rate. And then the other woman comes over. There's two older ladies, you know. And she goes, there's no tax on leather goods here. Okay. So that was pretty trippy. And then we stopped at the other places. We stopped at a, where's that guy? Antique mall. I like going in and trying to find toys, old toys. So this caught my eye. He plays the drums. Check it out.
Let me wind it up. There he goes.
And we gotta have that. But what he's playing is this. What he's playing. So I saw that. I went, what is that? It's made in Japan. I don't know if it's really old. We don't know. There's not much markings on it, but it does say made in Japan. So that's pretty good, you know, rather than China. That grooves like that. That whole groove thing, that's called syncopation. Syncopation's when you break up. Instead of playing straight, like linear, you had just this kind of pattern, which are the eighth notes, you'd be playing. You know, when you break it up like that, that's syncopation. This is not syncopation. That's straight ahead. Here's syncopation. Broken up with syncopation. Good stuff. I used to listen to a lot of R&B and funk when I grew up. I played when I was, how old was I, 15, 16, when I did the John Lennon thing, worked with John Lennon a little bit with my band. That band was a nine-piece band. We had bass, drums, guitar, vocalists. We had keyboards and four horn players. So it was really cool when you're playing and you do an accent. And on that accent, so four horn players blowing, you know. All the accents were great with the horn players. I showed this before, once before, twice before. That's the hardest thing to learn on drums. Not this. Not that. But this. That's too tight of a head. Yeah, it takes a long time to learn that, believe it or not. When I was in that band, for some reason we had a conga player come down and he showed me this thing. And what it is you're using your this finger and got just moistened it a little bit. And I'm going like this. I don't know if you can see that. Supporting the finger with the thumb. And I hit the drum and the skin vibrates. So what you're doing is you're catching the vibrations lightly. Cool. I used to do it when I was doing a lot of live drum clinics back in the days when they had a lot of live drum clinics. Yeah, and the whole big solo. And I'd ask the audience, any questions on what I just played? And I just played for 10 minutes. How did you do that thing at the end? I said, that's very hard. So it's just a matter of feeling, just touching the head like that. And you got to have a little moisture until you get it. You're catching the vibration. And one time I did a rock fantasy camp, and there's some young players there, some young drummers. And I showed that, and they were freaking out. Wow. So all for 4 days, all you heard in the rooms were, they're doing it too hard. You know, you're getting that. They couldn't figure it out, and there were all fingerprints all over the drum head, you know. I mean, you're doing this. That's not that. That's that. It's fun once you learn it, you know. It's a novelty item, I guess. But they do it on a conga players do it on a conga. And the way to do this is it's best to have used heads, some of them with a little bit of dents in them. These have very, very small dents in them. And that's what makes it work. You can't do it on a brand new skin. It's hard to do, you know. And I play with the butt end, you know. Play hard, but I don't have a lot of dents in the heads. They're very, very hardly any. And that's a sign of playing correctly, you know, because you don't want to dig into the drum and cause big dents, because then you kill the skin. These skins that are on here have a lot of tone left in them, you know, and that's because they're sitting on sawtooth drums. These drums are hickory drums, 6 plies of hickory, and there's no filler. Very, very, very good drums. Stainless steel lugs, and the hoop is die-cast, and there's dual 45-degree angles on each drum. That means that it's like this to a point. On each side is 45-degree. Skin sits on top, and it's just kind of floating almost, and that's why it's got a lot of tone. There you go. So this is the sawtooth, more expensive set of drums. Before that was the Command series I used, which sound great as well. So this is 6-ply mahogany, beautiful. This is a beautiful color, and the heads that are on are Evans G2s. If anybody's wondering, so they don't have dots on them. They're not muffled very much. Love that lick. See? What those are triplets. See? One and a two and a one. One and a two and a one. Then what I do is I play them across the drums. But I leave my hands in this position. I'm not even moving my hands. Look. I go. Up. and a two and a one. One and a two and a one. So I'm just moving the right hand, going from the snare to the floor tom. Same thing as doing this. One and a two and a one. One and a two and a one. Now you see, you got, with any type of drumming, any lick, you got, you can make different sounds from the same lick by just changing something slightly. So this one's starting on the snare. See? Boom. Now if I start on the floor tom, same stick positions, watch. I end on the snare, it sounds different. Go back to the first one. Next one. Which one do I like better? I like things that end on the big drum. You know, that's why these are all from high to low. This one sounds a little lighter. It's on the snare. See, now when you put them together with regular triplets on the snare, one and a two and a one and a two and a one and a two and a one and a two. And a, you get them faster. Do it with the mic in.
I can't do it at all.
Anyway, it's a really good lick. Anyway, let me tell you about a couple things here. Came home and I got this in the mailbox. It's the new Last in Line EP. Check that out on Ear Music. And this is how many songs are there? Five songs. It includes A Day in the Life, which we released last month, if you guys heard it. And two live versions, and then a new song called Hurricane Allah. And that kicks ass. Here's the back. And there's the back. The cool thing with the vinyls is you can look at the picture while you're listening to it. And you can't do that with CDs and downloads, right? Then the inside's got the picture of these guys. That's me over there next to the blonde guy. That's me. And this is coming out November's, I don't know. Sometime in November, there's a link.
I think.
Hey, it's Lala Lollipop.
Yeah, I'm here.
I didn't even see you.
Yeah, I came in here and you didn't notice.
When is it coming out?
November 11th, I believe.
Holy crap.
Yeah.
I got to get one.
I do.
Oh, I got one.
You got one.
And then this guy, smaller. This is a really cool record. This is the first song I played was from this record. This is with Jim Cream on vocal, Stephen Hound on guitar and bass, and myself on drums. This is called Scream Taker. This is a new project we did. Check it out. But I love the cover. It's kind of 50s. It's got the screaming girls, and then it's got the inside. It's a nice artwork on it, and then it's got a back. Is the back? This is out now. It's a cool album. A lot of the songs sound, everybody's saying it sounds like Dio and Sabbath, so you might want to check that out. It's really cool. And those drums were recorded here in this studio and using these drums. And they're really powerful and wide open, which is great. You know, they got all this nice ring like this. Hold your ears. Okay. Your ears are safe. Did anybody see the Dio movie?
Yeah, they were asking how it was a premiere.
Raise your hand up if you saw the movie. Not a lot of you saw the movie. Okay. The premiere was great. It was at the Man's Chinese Theater, which is called something else now, but the old Hollywood name is the Man's Chinese Theater. And that's the theater on Hollywood Boulevard in Hollywood that has all the footprints and the handprints of all the stars. And it's movie stars. It's not really rock stars. The rock stars are down the street, Guitar Center. In front of Guitar Center, there's a rock walk of fame. And actually, Ronnie's in that. And he did his handprints there. I think I'm there, too, with my pinky. That was it. Crazy. And the premiere was great, you know. We walked up. We had to go upstairs. And they had a red carpet thing where you know what this is? You get there and you get the backdrop. And then there's people you walk on. And what they do is they have a sign with your name. Because not everybody's going to know who some of the people are. Even me. I walked up. I was next. I'm going, who the frig is that? You know, who is that person? Why is he on the red carpet? At least I'm in the movie. Right? So you walk up and all the cameras click away. You go, hey, yo, yo. They're clicking away. And then they ask you a couple of questions. But before that, the girl has the card. It's Vinny Appice showing everybody. So it looks like, oh, yeah, we know who these people are, you know, whoever goes up. We know that guy. Probably owes me money. And the premiere was great. And then we walked in. We hung out there. There was a bar and everything. And then started making our way through. And the place was packed. And there were a lot of people there. Lita Ford was there. Who else was there? Mr. Lala?
Oh, I don't know. Rudy Sarza was
Rudy
there.
Rudy Sarza was there.
Tony Franklin.
Tony Franklin, my buddy. And who else?
Doug Aldridge was there. Craig Goldie was there.
Yeah, Craig Goldie, yeah. A lot of Dio alumni. Yeah. Simon Wright and Scott there. Warren. Yeah. The mystical Scott Warren was there. And it was cool, you know. And then we went in the theater. We better go up. Everybody's starting to go in. We go in and it's like packed. I think some people sat on the stairs, you know, and the movie was fantastic, and they did a phenomenal job on putting this together and editing, and with some, animation that's in it, and the storytelling was really good. So I was extremely. Where's that thing? Yeah, I was really, really surprised. I'm like, wow. And it told, you know, things about Ronnie that I didn't know. You know, I was very close to Ronnie, but we never sat down, you know, like me and Ronnie. How you doing, man? You okay? How's your heart? Are you happy? Or, you know, we didn't do that. You know, I don't do that with my brother, Carmine. Because if I did, he'd ask me for money or something. I don't know. So... No, we just don't do that. I'm Italian. I don't know. Maybe they did it. Let me get this thing here. In the old country, but, So there were things about Ronnie I didn't know. And in the movie, Wendy breaks out footage of he opens a closet, and there's a case, opens the case. There's Ronnie's trumpet. That's how he learned how to sing like that, from playing the trumpet and learning how to breathe circular. He told me that. Told me that's how I breathe when I sing, like a trumpet player, because his father made him play, 3 hours a day, you know, practicing. He wanted to be a trumpet. His father wanted him to be a trumpet player, and I don't think Ronnie wanted to be a trumpet player, but he wanted to play. So she breaks out his trumpet. I go, holy shite. There's the trumpet. I've never seen the trumpet, you know. He never said, hey, Vin, you want to see the trumpet? I don't know what I could have broke out from something from back then to, like, the triangle. Hey, Ron, you want to see the triangle? And So that was like, wow, that is cool. You know, very cool stuff. And it was a great movie. I'm in it a little bit, you know, and made the audience laugh a little bit because I told the story of when I joined Sabbath. I said, you know, back then, I mean, I was 20 years old, 21 years old, never really been around a Birmingham, England accent. You know, it's very heavy English accent. And they had the mustaches and they were scary. That's what I said in the movie, and they were, to me, I go, wow, these guys look evil, you know? Not Ronnie, but Tony and Keezer. And then a lot of times I couldn't understand what they said. They would say something, and I go, okay. Then I'd go over to Ron and go, hey, Ron, what did they say? What did they say? Until I got to know them, you know? And then I think my Brooklyn accent rubbed off on them. But anyway, the movie was great. It was kind of sad at the end, very sad. And they gave out these cool tissues. Check it out.
You see that? There you go. That's a little better.
There go the tissues. We needed one of these. Whoa. There we go. So the movie was great. If you can go see it, go see it. I don't know. It's not playing in many theaters, and it's not playing very long in the theaters.
No,
so
I think it's done.
I think it's done, right?
Yeah, I think so.
So I think what you need to do is write your senators and your politician guys. Tell them you want to see the movie, goddammit. Yeah, I don't know why. I think it did really good. So they should have extended it, you know. So it's probably going to come out on Netflix or Amazon
or something,
or Hulu or all this other stuff, Disney Plus and this Plus, and everything's Plus now, you know. Like, you have the original channels now it's Plus. Now I gotta buy the Plus. What was wrong with the regular one? You know, they start coming out with the things and promoting them. Now I gotta get Plus. Yeah, so anyway, keep your eye out for them. And I enjoyed the movie. It was this one part that it was a little actually, people were writing to me saying this part when they said this, I don't even remember that, you know. I got to see it again because my mind was wandering. Where It Will Go, that's from a song, isn't it? Okay, so we're going to take some questions. But somebody was at the door. We flew in yesterday to San Diego and went to a favorite Mexican place, which is called, what is it called, Miguel's?
I think so, yeah.
Man, that place is so good.
So good.
The beans, the refried beans, just so tasty. They don't taste like a bunch of lard like some other places. They're really spicy enough, and they just taste wonderful. And the rice is good. Beautiful. And there's cheesy enchiladas were great, and the beef taco is awesome. I'm going to make all you guys hungry. And there's another place in San Diego, we call it the cheese place, because there's so much cheese on everything. You need a scissor to go in there to try to get a forkful or something. Way too much cheese. It's stupid. Ridiculous. They could save money. They should get John Taffer from Bar Rescue. You're serving too much food, too much cheese. Okay, let's take some questions.
Okay.
Again, thank you, Sawtooth and the Hickory Drums. And Chromacast, this is Chromacast Hardware. That's what these two signs are. And thank you guys for tuning in again. I'll be back for another couple of weeks, and then I got to go back to work. Okay, what do we got?
What is the right round device in front of your bass drum?
I knew you were going to say that.
Yeah. You can see it.
You know what? This is real high tech. I'm going to ask Lala to just turn the camera down a little bit. See where it is now? It's halfway. Just take the top. No. That. Nope, the camera itself. Look. You're going to move that. Pop it down. That's good. That was good. You still see me. Okay, that's good. Leave it like that. What that is that's a woofer. It's called a subwoofer or something. And that is a 6-inch speaker in there. I got it on Amazon. It's 6-inch speaker wired as a microphone. So what you're getting, nice low end from it. And there's a mic inside, which is a 91 flat mic. Sure. And that's getting the attack and the click and all that. So you combine them. I used to use an 8-inch that I took out of a monitor, studio monitor, and I put that in front of it. It was hard to hang because the magnet was so heavy. And that was even lower frequency it captured. But the problem was, I wired it, and sometimes it would crackle and all that stuff. So, but this you can buy. They're about 100, what are they, 100, 200 bucks or something? And, so that's what that is, And for some reason, I didn't get the black one. I got the white one. And I thought, if I put that in the picture, somebody's going to ask, what the hell is that? So. All right, next question.
What was your favorite decade of your career?
My favorite decade of the career? I've been fortunate enough, just as I say, these two albums are just coming out, and I've been doing this for a long time. And I'm pretty fortunate to have this stuff coming out and being busy and all that stuff, because I've been playing for a long time. Decade, probably the 80s when Holy Diver came out, or Mob Rules. I mean, I can't even pick one. When I joined Sabbath, Mob Rules went right into arenas, playing with this legendary band. And then we made an album together. Then we played that stuff. I mean, that was incredible. Then we went to Dio and made Holy Diver. So, and then Last in Line album. And that was a highlight, And then later on, I played in a number of different bands, World War III and Kill Devil Hill. And I loved playing with those guys. It was a smaller thing. But later on, we did Sabbath again, Dehumanizer album. That was great for me. And then later on, Heaven and Hell. And that was a big thing, And we were kicking ass together, and we made an album. And so I had a lot of highlights, thanks to you guys, If nobody bought the records or listened, we'd be at home doing streams. So, all right, how about one more question? Or two more?
Two more questions. I find it difficult to get around to the floor tom from the rack tom. Any tips?
Yes, change your sticking. Instead of going like this, that's easy when you do it slow. But you can change the sticking. Wait a minute. It comes naturally to me. So you put a double at the end. So you can crash, it leaves your hand to crash instead of winding up on the So you can do either way. You can do straight singles. My sticking there is leaves my hand free to get to the crash cymbal. So that's what you got to do is. Right. Do it that way too. So just try messing with different stickings. And you'll get there. Okay, next question. Okay.
What is your favorite horror movie and horror song?
Horror movie?
Svengoolie.
Well, we watched Svengoolie from Chicago. He has all these terrible movies on, but he makes it fun. I like House on a Haunted Hill, old Vincent Price movie. I like the old Frankenstein, Dracula, all that old stuff. love that stuff. But a lot of times I fall asleep in the middle because it's so quiet and there's not a lot of bombs exploding and guns shooting off, you know. It's like a play, some of those old movies, you know. So I like those movies. And my other movie is Goodfellas because I'm Italian. I love that movie. Okay, how about another question, Lala?
What's your favorite song to rock with Rick?
Scary song, too. The scary song is Black Sabbath. I mean, that doesn't get much scarier than that. But that's slow, too. Okay, what was the next question?
What is your favorite song to rock with Rick Derringer?
With Rick Derringer, there's a song called Beyond the Universe that we did on the first album. It's this tempo. And then there's a drum solo. I played different back then. But at the end of the drum solo, I finished and I went. See this? But I didn't have a bigger bass. You know, these drums are closer together. I go. And I got back in. I was younger then. It was faster. My shoulders moved faster. So check it out. Beyond the Universe on the first Derringer album. Kick-ass song. Okay, so anyway, thank you for joining me. I'll be back next week for another fun-packed-filled whatever. And coming up on Halloween, too, so that'd be cool. So I'll be back next Tuesday. Thank you guys for joining me. Be safe, and check out those albums. They're really good, and you can pre-order the Last in Line, too. And we had a ball on meeting everybody on the road. A lot of people watched the show that I met on the road, so it was really cool. Really cool. Thank you guys for that. So we'll see you next week.